So, hello friends, presenting the next syndrome of the week. So, let's see the case scenario for this week. This week's case is about a kid, young kid, 3-year-old kid, who was admitted to hospital for evaluation of steatorrhea and snort stature. Okay, his past history, the kid's past history included, the kid was born at 36 weeks with birth weight of 2 kg and height 51 centimeter. So, low birth weight was present. Early growth and development was normal, but once the kid did 7 months of age, the kid started to have frequent ear infection, purulent otitis media, and frequent respiratory tract infection. So pneumonia, the kid used to develop multiple episodes. And once the teeth started developing, the kid had dental caries as well. This was also recurrent. During late infancy, the kid also developed steatorrhea. Means the kid passed large volume of stools, inappropriate for its age, and which was foul smelling also. Her height and weight was less than third percentile, so growth retardation was present, but head circumference was normal within the 50th percentile for the given age. Vital signs were normal for the age. Angular stomatitis was present, dental caries was present on head to toe examination, and rest of the examinations remained normal. So, going by the history, the kid has malabsorption in terms of steatorrhea. So some features, because she is having angular stomatitis also, that also can be secondary to malabsorption, because fat soluble vitamins, vitamin A, D, E, K won't be absorbed. Next, the kid is having growth retardation because height and weight is less. It is less than third centile. The kid is having recurrent infections also. Okay, recurrent infections. So this infection is mainly, since the kid is having recurrent infection. By this, we can come to a what all differential diagnosis we can think of. What all differential diagnosis. Since the disease is having growth retardation, it's malabsorption since a long time, it points towards a chronic disease with recurrent infections from the childhood, from its infancy, it's been having. So since it's having RS features and abdominal features, it's natural for us to think of cystic fibrosis. Next, because it's having malabsorption, we can think something like celiac disease or other malabsorption disorders in child. Okay, so we can think of this. Next, we can think of something like, since only GI tract and respiratory tract is affected, we can think of selective IgA deficiency. Very rarely we can put this into our differential diagnosis as well. But on moving forward and doing investigations, CBC revealed low counts in all the panels. All the panels revealed lower range count. HB was less, WBC was less, platelets also was less. So this was pointing towards pancytopenia picture. Malabsorption was secondary to exocrine pancreatic deficiency. So there is fat malabsorption. So serum amylase and lipase as well was low. On radiologic examination, certain bone deformities was present. Mainly metaphyseal dysplasia was present. It showed transverse sclerotic changes detected at metaphysis of distal femur. And abdominal CT scan, it revealed that when we compare this with normal CT scan of the pancreas, it shows that there is less attenuation. There is decreased less attenuation of the pancreas is found. Okay, this will be probably due to, when we match it with the scale, this was because of fatty infiltration. It was because of fatty infiltration. Same patient, when bone marrow examination was done, bone marrow was hypocellular with fatty infiltration. So now we can make a diagnosis of something with pancytopenia with these features. Since it's a very young kid presenting with features of bone marrow failure because there is hypocellular bone marrow on examination, we can think of inherited pancytopenias. Among them, with these clinical features, along with pancreatic exocrine insufficiency and growth retardation, we can think of Swamen-Diamond syndrome. Okay, so what are the inherited pancytopenias? What are inherited pancytopenias? One is Fanconi, one is Swamen-Diamond syndrome, other one is dyskeratosis congenita, congenital amegakaryocytic thrombocytopenia, some few genetic syndromes like Down syndrome, Dubose syndrome, Sickle syndrome, Noonan syndrome, all these things can as well present. So these inherited pancytopenias, how do we diagnose? One is based on CBC. So we'll get to know that it is pancytopenia. Next, by doing bone marrow examination, there will be hypocellular marrow. So this will point, there are other etiologies also. But once we think of inherited, then we look for associated features. We look for associated features. These associated features will be characteristic. Like if we take Fanconi, there will be characteristic faces, there will be some certain limb deformities, like thumb might not be there. There might be the radii bone might be absent, radii or ulnar bone might be absent. All these things will be present. Similarly, Swam and Diamond, it is associated with exocrine pancreatic insufficiency. So such associated features we look for to diagnose inherited pancytopenia. Coming to the syndrome as such, it is inherited condition, autosomal recessive inheritance. Okay. What is the mutation that is present in SBDS gene? Where is it located? On chromosome number 7q11. What does this do? One, there will be failure of pancreatic SNR development, this will lead to exocrine insufficiency. Next is there will be bone marrow failure. This will lead to dysfunctional hematopoietic stem cells. One more is accelerated apoptosis. This will lead to pancytopenia picture. Next, there will be associated immune abnormalities as well. So immune system as well will be abnormalities. This also can contribute to recurrent infections, along with pancytopenia can contribute to recurrent infections. So what can we expect in our clinical features based on this pathogenesis? Fat malabsorption due to exocrine pancreatic insufficiency and features of vitamin deficiency disorders, along with pancytopenia, anemia will be there, features of anemia like fatigue, lethargy, all those things. Very classical for this is neutropenia. At least once in its childhood, the patient will have one location of neutropenia, at least one episode of neutropenia will be there, and thrombocytopenia. But all these three features are not always present. Leukopenia is almost always present, but when it comes to anemia, it will be present in almost 60% of the cases. If it is thrombocytopenia, again 60% of the cases. If it is pancytopenia, around 45% of the cases, like that. Okay, that is how the patient presents. Followed by associated features. We'll have to look for associated features. One is short stature, either because of the chronic nature of the disease, or few patients will have growth hormone abnormalities as well. Next is bone deformities, wherein there will be delayed bone maturation, which as well can contribute to short stature, metaphyseal dysplasia as found in our radiological finding, thoracic abnormality, all these things will be there. Then certain neurocognitive problems will lead to poor sociological skills, all those things. Okay. It can lead to mental retardation and all. Dental abnormalities and poor oral health was present in our case again. Now, how do we diagnose? One is bone marrow insufficiency. One more is based on exocrine pancreatic insufficiency. Bone marrow insufficiency, how will we find? On doing CBC. One more, as mentioned, neutropenia, at least 100% of the cases, on at least one location will have neutropenia. One more is bone marrow examination will show hypoplasia with fatty infiltration. Pancreatic insufficiency, decreased serum trypsinogen and isoamylase level. 72-hour fat assay will reveal increased fat in stools. And on CT, important why we have to monitor CBC in this patient is, one is pancytopenia and it might require transfusion. Other one is we look for features of MDS. So CBC with peripheral smear have to be done. MDS, myelodysplastic syndrome, and leukemic transformation also takes place. Most of the patients might land up with this. So we'll have to do, to diagnose early, we'll have to do regular CBC along with peripheral smear. So how do we treat? One is pancreatic enzyme replacement along with vitamin supplements. Next, monitor blood count, because the patient might require transfusion or correction, or it might become malignant transfusion, to monitor that. If there is neutropenia, we can do subcutaneous colony stimulating factor. If erythropoietin can be required, blood transfusions can be required, or androgen and steroids can be required to increase the counts. Definitive treatment as such is hematopoietic stem cell transplantation. So this was to do with today's case. So this week's case was Swamin-Diamond syndrome. Hope it was useful. Thank you guys. Bye bye.